Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, people of God, wherever you are. I'm glad that you're here to join us for Sunday Adult Education. Over the last few weeks in church on Sunday, we've been going through our sermon series, We've Built a Bakery. And this is all sort of gathered around the passage in John 6 where Jesus calls himself the bread of life. And so today what I want to do is I want to engage in an exercise in scriptural interpretation. And I want to take a look at our gospel reading that you would have heard read this morning and kind of take a look at that in its context and then ask ourselves, how should we read this? And then how can we apply that to other passages of scripture that we might come across? And so I hope that this study will be a blessing to you. I pray that you're well. And again, remember, Jesus is the bread of life. He continues to feed us through his word. So let's gather together and let's hear that word. Let's pray. Dear gracious Heavenly Father, I thank you for Jesus, the bread of life. I thank you that he continues to feed us with the promise of eternal life that we hear echoed in John 6. I pray that you would be with us today as we gather around your word. I pray that it would be a blessing to us and that you would sharpen our senses that we might engage that word and properly hear what you have to say to us today. All this I ask in the name of your son, Jesus. Amen. So in John 6, verses 53 through 58, by the way, the title of today's lesson is In Communion with Jesus and with One Another. And we're going to get to that as we take a look at what Jesus has to say to us today in John. But in John 6, verses 53 through 58, Jesus says something really, really strange. And you can picture the people of his day who would have heard him say this, how they might have reacted to it. But you heard this read in church this morning, and I'm going to go ahead and read it now. John 6, 53 through 58. Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise them up on the last day. For my flesh is real food, and my blood is real drink. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood remains in me, and I in them. Just as the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so the one who feeds on me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven. Your ancestors ate manna and died, but whoever feeds on this bread will live forever." Okay, so Jesus says something really, really strange here, and I know what all of you are thinking. Communion, right? That's what this is about, right? He's telling us to eat his flesh and drink his blood, which is what we do every Sunday. But I don't want us to jump right to that this morning. Okay, because we have to read this verse within its context. And any time, by the way, you're engaging with a piece of scripture, there's sort of a move that happens, right? You go from the very, 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 very broad to the very, 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 very narrow. And if we just take this verse on its own, right, if we just read John 6, 53 through 58, we really don't know what is going on here. We don't know what Jesus is addressing. We don't know what's come before this. We don't know what's come after it. And so we really need to engage with that part of Scripture if we're going to have any understanding at all of what Jesus is really getting at here. And so that's what I want us to do today. And so the first question that we need to ask ourselves is, where does this particular passage of Scripture, where these five verses fit within the totality of John's gospel? Within the totality of the book of John, where does this little passage fit? And so let's take a look at it. What is going on in John by the time this comes along? Well, in John 1, you have John's prologue. And this is a very famous piece of scripture where John introduces Jesus as the Word. And last week we talked a little bit about this, how when John says, "In the beginning was the Word," he's saying that Jesus is the wisdom and revelation of God, right? Then we hear John the Baptist's testimony, right? Where John says, "I'm not the Christ," and then he sees Jesus and he says, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." Then we see the calling of the first disciples, and we're off and running. Jesus' command to follow me. Then, by the time we get to John 2, Jesus is already performing miracles. There's the wedding at Cana, where Jesus turns water into wine, right? And then Jesus clears the temple, right? He goes straight to Jerusalem, clears the temple. Then we have this account of Jesus and Nicodemus in John 3, where Nicodemus the Pharisee comes to Jesus at night and asks him a series of questions about who he is. And Jesus tries to explain, but Nicodemus only has a partial understanding of the message of Jesus and the work of Jesus and who Jesus really is. Then in John 4, we have this really interesting account of Jesus and the Samaritan woman at the well and Jesus healing an official's son. In both cases, we see the work of Jesus expanding to people outside of the Jewish nation, to Samaritans and then to an official's son. And then in John 5, we see Jesus healing a lame man, then his claim to be the Son of God. And this is really where tensions start to escalate between him and the religious authorities of his day. And then we're in John 6, okay? So this is everything that's came before to get us to John 6. And then by the time we get to John 6, Jesus feeds the 5,000 with this incredible feeding from 5 loaves and 2 fish. Jesus walks on water. Again, incredible miracles here. Then there's this section called the Bread of Life Discourse. I am the bread of life. Okay. Now, we can look at this in a couple of different ways, right? We could look at all of the different I am statements in John to see how this particular statement fits in with that. But really, what I want us to do today is to really consider these 5 verses, right? John 6, 53 through 58, in the context of John. So John 6, right? This is really where we want to hone in on. Jesus feeds the 5,000, Jesus walks on water, and then there's this bread of life discourse that verses 53 through 58 are a part of. Okay, so are you tracking with me here? I hope that you are. Okay, so what we've done here is we're considering these 5 verses in a very broad sense, right? We're looking at all of John, and we're saying, okay, these 5 verses fit here, right? That's what we're doing. So we can see everything that's come before so that we can consider the context that this falls into. Now, what about John 6 as a whole? So now we're going to narrow our focus a little bit, and we're going to look at John 6. So what's happening there? So at the beginning of John 6, Jesus has gathered this incredible following of people because they've heard of the miracles and the signs that he's doing. That word sign is very, very important in John. But they've heard about everything that Jesus is doing, and so they're following him around to see what he's going to do next, okay? And so there's this huge amalgamation of people, and he feeds them. He feeds them with 5 loaves and 2 fish. And based on that, there's an even bigger gathering of people that gather around him. And in John 6, they try to force him to be their king, okay? They see everything that he's done and they try to force him to be king. And Jesus leaves, right? He doesn't want that. He doesn't want anything to do with that. And so he leaves and crosses over the Sea of Galilee, okay? The disciples cross by boat. Jesus walks on water, okay? And goes to the other side of the Sea of Galilee. And he ends up in Capernaum, okay? That's where all this is going to be happening at, this bread of life discourse. So if you look, again, this is the context that this kind of falls into, right? Keep in mind, Jesus has a big following, a bunch of people who really like the miracles. They think that's really cool. They like what he's doing. Perhaps some of them were fed in this 5,000. They really, really like that. And they're following Jesus to see, okay, what are you going to do next? Okay, it's really important to keep this in mind. Big following, like the miracles, they're following him, right? And Jesus doesn't want anything to do with this earthly kingdom, and he walks on water, right? And there's some symbolism there too, I think, because there's a big group of people who are following him expecting to see a miracle, and yet the only people who see this miracle are the disciples who are in the boat, right? Jesus walking on water. So they go to the other side of the lake, and then they end up in Capernaum, okay? So that gets us to the bread of life discourse, which is where this particular passage falls into. These five verses fall into what we call the bread of life discourse, okay? And here, Jesus enters Capernaum, as we've said, by way of the Sea of Galilee. And what he's doing here is he's speaking in the synagogue, right? This is a religious discourse, if you will, that's happening here. And so this is kind of the flow of the argument that Jesus is making. And off to the side here, I've attached the verses that you can find where Jesus is making these points throughout this discourse, the bread of life discourse, okay? So Jesus is in Capernaum, and the first thing that Jesus does is he makes this distinction between physical food and spiritual food, right? That's the first thing that he does. He says to the crowds, you're gathered here because you ate bread, right? Well, I have food that you don't know about. I have better food. I have spiritual food to give you. Okay? And Jesus says, I do the work of my Father in heaven. And so the crowds want to know what the work of God is. They ask Jesus a theological question. They say, what is the work of God and how do we do that work? And Jesus replies real simply. He says, the work of God is to believe in the one that he has sent. To believe the words of the one that he has sent. In other words, Jesus has been very clear that the Father has sent him. And he's saying, the only work that God wants from you is to believe in me, okay? Very, very important. The only work that God is asking from you is to believe in me, to believe the words that I am saying. And so the crowd, for the first time, pushes back against Jesus. They ask for proof, okay? They say, okay, we've heard about all these signs that you're doing. We've heard about the feeding of the 5,000. We've heard of all of these things. So if you're going to make a claim like that, we want proof. What sign are you going to give us so that we may believe what you have to say to us, right? So they're asking for proof. So and Jesus doesn't give it to him, right? Jesus doesn't do any miraculous sign here. But Jesus, again, makes another distinction, right, between bread from heaven, which is manna, with true bread from heaven. Okay, so he makes this distinction in verses 32 through 34. And Jesus is hearkening back, again, it's a religious discourse, it's happening in the synagogue, and Jesus is hearkening back to the account of God's people in the wilderness, right? In the book of Exodus, God's people were trudging through the wilderness, and they didn't have anything to eat, and God fed them with this mysterious bread from heaven. And it was scattered on the ground, it looked like snow, and people would pick it up, and they didn't know what it was, and so they named it manna, which means what is it? They didn't know what it was. And Jesus compares this bread from heaven with true bread from heaven. Okay? So he's saying that this true bread from heaven is better than the bread that their ancestors ate in the wilderness. And then in verse 35, here it is, Jesus identifies himself as that bread. He says, I am the true bread from heaven. So really what Jesus is saying here is he's saying the manna that your ancestors ate was good because it was fed to them by God. I'm better. I'm the true bread that's come down from heaven, okay? So this is in verse 35. Jesus identifies himself as that bread. And then in verses 35 through 40, Jesus makes another massive, massive claim. So keep in mind, the people have just asked him for a sign, right? Because he said, the will of God, the work of God is to believe the words that I say. But here he's going to make an even bigger claim. He is going to claim the authority to save and to raise from death those who believe in him. Okay? So Jesus, not only is he not giving in to what the people want, he's not giving them this sign, he's not giving them a miracle, but then he makes an even bigger claim, right? Before he just said, God wants you to believe in me, and now he's saying, I can save you and raise you from death, right? Really, really big claims that Jesus is saying here, okay? So I want to break this down for us because this is really, really, really dense stuff, right? This is really thick, and I want to make sure that we get this. So where we've come, right, so far in the argument that Jesus is laying out, in the discourse that Jesus is laying out, goes something like this, okay? Bread of heaven is better than manna. Okay, remember that. Bread of heaven is better than manna, and Jesus is that bread. Jesus calls himself the true bread from heaven. To believe the words that Jesus says is to be fed by him. The one who believes belongs to Jesus, and he will raise them up on the last day. And bread of heaven feeds for eternity, and if you eat manna, you're still going to die. Okay, so it's kind of a full circle argument. Bread of heaven is better than manna. Jesus is that bread. To believe the words that Jesus says is to be fed by that bread. And what happens if you eat that bread, you belong to Jesus. He's going to raise you up on the last day. So this bread is better than manna because those who ate manna died, but bread of heaven will feed you for an eternity. Okay, so I hope that we're tracking with this. This is kind of the argument that Jesus is laying out. So the crowds don't like this, okay? They push back even harder. So Jesus makes this claim about himself, right? That he can save, that he can raise from death, and the crowds don't like it. And now they're going to start questioning the authority of Jesus, right? They say, what does he mean he's the bread from heaven? How could he be from heaven? We know his mother Mary. We know his father Joseph, right? How could he be from heaven? Right? And so Jesus asserts here where his authority comes from. Okay, he hears the grumbling, he hears the questioning, and he says, I don't have any authority on my own. All of this comes from the Father, right? He's the one in charge. And then again, Jesus makes this claim that the bread of heaven, the bread that he offers himself, is better than manna, verses 47 through 50. Then we're getting into this passage, right? These five verses that we identified right at the beginning. Jesus says that the bread that he offers is his flesh, okay? That he will give for the life of the world. That's in verse 51, right? This true bread is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. And now the crowds are getting really, really heated, okay, by verse 52. They don't like this at all, okay? So this is where we get to this passage, okay? This is the entire argument that Jesus is laying out. So you can kind of see Jesus is going from kind of the very, very general to the very, very specific, right? He's talking about manna, true bread from heaven. I am that bread from heaven. I'm going to feed you. Here's how I'm going to do it. You believe the words that I say to you. And if you do that, I raise you up at the last day. And by the way, my flesh is that bread. I'm going to give it for the life of the world, right? And now the crowds really don't like it. They're like, what in the world is this crackpot talking about? We're supposed to eat his flesh? So then Jesus is like, well, if you like that, you're really going to like what I say next. And that gets us into this passage, okay? So I'm going to read this again slowly so that we can put this into context of everything that we've read so far, okay? Jesus said to them, very truly I tell you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise them up at the last day. For my flesh is real food, and my blood is real drink. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood remains in me, and I in them. Just as the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so the one who feeds on me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven. Your ancestors ate manna and died, but whoever feeds on this bread will live forever. Okay? So, within the context of everything that we've read so far, Jesus has said, to do the will of God is to believe the words that I say. The benefit to believing that word is that you're going to be fed by this true bread, which is me. And the benefit to that is that you're going to live forever, and I will raise you up at the last day, okay? And that gets us to this passage, okay? So if you go all the way back, Jesus is making some really, really, really hard claims here, okay? He's saying some things that are divisive. He's saying some things that are very, very, very difficult. And we have to ask ourselves the question, is Jesus doing this intentionally? Because I think he probably is, all right? I think this is his way of seeing who really believes the words that he says, okay? Because keep in mind, so far, Jesus has claimed to be the Son of God. Jesus has claimed that he has been sent by the Father. He claims that all his authority comes from the Father. He's claiming the authority to save, the authority to raise from death. And now he's saying, you've got to eat my flesh and drink my blood if you want to abide with me, if you want to partake in that life, if you want to be fed, this is what you got to do. Okay, so the crowds are just going nuts by this point, okay? So what is the result of all of this, right? What's the result of Jesus saying this? Well, here's why I think that Jesus is being very intentional with what he's saying. If you look at verses 60 through 66, right? So this is what comes after this bread of life discourse. It says that many disciples desert Jesus. Okay? They say, these words are too hard, we can't follow you anymore, and they desert Jesus. And so Jesus comes to the 12, right, the 12 disciples, and says, are you going to leave too? And Peter makes this great confession. He says, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. And so Peter recognizes, right, that the words that Jesus speaks are in themselves life. And so the true believers, right, these disciples, confess Jesus as the Holy One of God. So they believe the words that Jesus says, and they believe his words are life. Okay, so this is in verses 66 through 68. So that's the result, right? Jesus's flock, Jesus's following, gets smaller, significantly smaller, because of what Jesus has said in this bread of life discourse. And so what are we to take away from all of this, okay? What are we to take away from this discourse, these difficult words that Jesus says to us? Well, I want to talk for a minute about communion, okay? Because I think that this really ties in well with what Jesus is getting at in John 6. So when we commune, we partake of the body and blood of Jesus, receiving the eternal life that he promises. Now, how do we know this? How can we be sure of this? Well, we take Jesus at his word. Okay? Like those first disciples in John 6, we believe the words that Jesus says because we know that in those words we have life. And to do this, right, puts us in communion or fellowship with Jesus. As Jesus says in John 6, 56, if you believe the words that I say, if you eat my flesh and drink my blood, I will abide with you. Okay, so to do this puts us in fellowship and communion with Jesus. And so this is where we get into our understanding of the bread and wine and the body and blood of Jesus, which we feed on every Sunday when we come to communion. Communion is very important to us here at King of Glory. And so it's worth kind of looking back at what Luther's catechism, this is the small catechism, says about communion. Okay, and this echoes what Jesus himself says in John 6, this passage that we just read. What is the sacrament of the altar? It is the true body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ under bread and wine instituted by Christ himself for us Christians to eat and to drink. Where is this written? The holy evangelists Matthew, Mark, Luke, and St. Paul write, and then you hear the words of institution, those words that we hear every Sunday. On the night when our Lord was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, take and eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And we see these words in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and even St. Paul writes about it too. So this is where we get this from, okay? Luther goes on. Who receives this sacrament worthily? Okay, so if you've ever wondered who should commune, here's your answer right here. who receives this sacrament worthily? Fasting and bodily preparation are certainly fine outward training, because at the time of Luther, right, people would fast to prepare to go to communion to receive the sacrament from the priest, right? Fasting and bodily preparation are certainly fine outward training. So Luther's saying that's fine to do, but that person is truly worthy, so here's what really matters, and well prepared, who has faith in these words, given and shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. But anyone who does not believe these words or doubts them is unworthy and unprepared. For the words "for you" require all hearts to believe, right? So here's what Luther has to say about this. Again, it all comes back to taking Jesus at his word. Remember what Jesus says in John 6. The will of God, the work of God, is to believe in the one that he has sent and to believe the words that he speaks, which are life, which feed us far better than manna or any other bread could. Jesus is the true bread who's come down from heaven. And so, when we commune, we have fellowship with one another. Remember, in John 6, what brings this final group of followers together, these disciples, after all of these people desert Jesus, what brings them together is that they believe the words that Jesus speaks, and that's what brings them together. So when we commune, we take Jesus at his word, we believe what he says, and so we have fellowship with one another. We who commune together are brought together by our faith and trust in the words of Jesus, just as those first disciples were. And the words and promises of Jesus apply to us as well. Right? So again, going back to this passage, if you look at it, Jesus makes some pretty astonishing claims and asks us to take him at his word, right? That he has the power to save, that he has the power to raise from death, and that the way that he does this is to feed us the true bread, his flesh, which we feed on when we come to communion, right? And it's something that our human reason could never grasp. Just as the crowds, right, that followed Jesus up to John 6 and eventually deserted him. They were following Jesus because they had seen all of these incredible signs and wonders that he had done. But when Jesus said this, their reason couldn't grasp it, right? They couldn't grasp it fully, and so they deserted him, right? And so those who stuck around, those who stayed with Jesus, those who Jesus abided with, right, those who had fellowship with Jesus were those who took him at his word and believed these sayings, even though they were quite difficult. So I pray that this has been a blessing to you, and I hope that you can apply this same technique to other passages in the Bible that you might read. Remember, always consider any passage in its big context, right, in the broad context of wherever you're reading it. Then you can narrow it down, and then finally consider the passage itself, and then maybe take a look at what comes after it so you can see what the result is of whatever happens there. And then you'll have a much better understanding of what Jesus is actually saying as he speaks to us through his word. Let's pray. Dear gracious Heavenly Father, I thank you for these incredible promises from Jesus. Hard words to be sure, hard words for us to understand, hard words for us to believe. And on our own, Father, we know that we have no chance of believing. But Father, we ask that you would send your Holy Spirit among us and that you would increase in us true faith, that we might hear the words that Jesus speaks to us and that we might be fed by them, that we might be fed abundantly by these words, Father. I pray that Jesus would continue to abide with us, that we would continue to trust him, to take him at his word, and that again, we would continue to be fed by the words that he speaks, so that we too might experience the resurrection on the last day. All this I pray in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. God's peace be with you. I pray that your week goes well. And remember, continue to believe the words of Jesus, continue to be fed. Bye.